Amplification?
Yeah.
You really think I need amplification?
not now.
That's good. Keep shouting. That's great.
Okay.
So give it again another minute or two, people.
Okay.
Getting rid of their plates. Why don't you go?
Okay, so we can.
This is Chris.
Yes, I'm me. So this is a new talk about old things, and so partly even my PhD thesis, which was 32 years ago, but also some of the work that I did here as a postdoc. And interestingly enough, there's been a resurgence of interest in the whole question of when can you embed computation in dynamical systems, including in things like fluid flow, due to some recent mathematical results. So some very nice people invited me to Barcelona to give a talk about this stuff at the Hypatia, or closer, I'm told, Hypatia summer school. So here are some images of Hypatia. We don't know, of course, what she looked like, but she seems like, like many people in history, it would have been very nice to get to know her. We know that she was murdered by a Christian mob, but maybe more importantly, we know that she loved conic sections and edited and perhaps extended some works of Ptolemy and Diophantus and so on. So she was a Neoplatonist philosopher, geometer, astronomer back when those were all one field. So, you know, like we now know them to be again. So we actually heard from Gulci yesterday about the P versus NP question, and roughly speaking, the P versus NP question is, do we have to search, or when do we have to search? So this is a classic problem called Hamiltonian path, where we are trying to visit every vertex in a graph exactly once, a kind of simplified version of the traveling salesman problem. This is an unsuccessfully marketed game by Mr. Hamilton, where one player would do the first few steps and then the other player would try to continue it. And the interesting thing about this problem is that we really have no idea how to solve it on general graphs much more efficiently than through exhaustive search. So here you see the beginnings of a potentially exponentially large search tree where we take a step and then we have two choices and then after that we have two choices and so on. So you can imagine that there could be an exponential number of potential paths. For some problems, you don't need to search. You can skip over the search. There's an algorithmic shortcut. But for some, we believe that there really is no such shortcut. And there's strong evidence, which I won't tell you about, that that's the case. There's a nice analogy here, I think, with dynamical systems. So when we look at a chaotic dynamical system like this Lorentz oscillator, we strongly believe that the only way to predict its state, time t in the future, is to carefully integrate it numerically. And indeed, if it's chaotic, you have to do that with higher and higher precision as the time you're trying to predict goes farther forward. And this is in distinction to a harmonic oscillator where its position at time t is sine of t or cosine of t. And there, that's a formula. If you want to know the state at time t, we'll just plug it in. There's no need to integrate all of the intervening time. So if a dynamical system is capable of computation, well, then predicting it is just as hard as predicting what a computer will do. In other words, if you can predict it, you can do the computation that it does, and that would then be strong evidence that it is hard to predict if it's solving a computationally hard problem.
Is the converse true?
Maybe. Yes. No, not necessarily.
Necessarily.
Not necessarily. Yeah, actually, I'm going to talk about that. Sorry, it took me a moment to parse. In the late 90s, John Makhta and I thought about the computational complexity of various problems in statistical physics. So here, for instance, is a kind of cluster growth. It is called internal diffusion-limited aggregation. You may be familiar with standard diffusion-limited aggregation, which builds all sorts of dendritic structures. This one sort of eats out a cavity from inside, so its clusters are rounder. And we were able to, in a certain sense, nail down its level of computational complexity by trying to figure out how the interacting particles that make it up can carry out logical operations. And here the question is, do I have to individually take a particle, have it wiggle, 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 wiggle until it hits the boundary, and do that again and do that again? Or is there some way to parallelize a lot of this process rather than doing it sequentially one particle at a time? And so John devised an algorithm which does parallelize it quite a bit, but we think not exponentially. So in other words, it still takes some power law in the number of particles to carry this out. So now, let me, and again, Gulchi talked about this a little bit, but what do we mean by computation? So as many of you know, in the Annus Mirabilis of 1936, it was made pretty clear that we understand what we mean by computation in the discrete case. I won't belabor this, but here is a Turing machine writing and reading things on a tape. Here is a Boolean circuit with logical operators that produce a result. Strictly speaking, what we need here is an entire family of Boolean circuits, one for each size. Gulchi mentioned that yesterday. And here is a program written in your favorite programming language. And we know from the work of Turing and Church that these things are all equally capable. Each one can simulate the others. And this strongly suggests that we understand what computation means in a discrete context, because it seems that every reasonable model is equivalent. Now, let me remind you of the halting problem. Here is a program which searches larger and larger integers looking for counterexamples to Fermat's last theorem. We now know Fermat's last theorem is true, but suppose we didn't. I don't actually want to run this program, of course, because it will take a very long time, and indeed it will take forever if Fermat's last theorem is true, because it only stops if it finds a counterexample. So wouldn't it be wonderful or terrible if we could, without actually running this program, just look at it and tell in finite time whether it will ever halt? And again, I don't mean running it, because if it's been running for a trillion years, you still don't know whether it will eventually halt or not. I mean looking forward into the future and in a finite amount of time by observing the program, by looking at its source code, figuring out whether it will ever halt. I say that this would be terrible because it would represent the completion and therefore the death of most of mathematics. Good news, this is not possible, as many of you know, because if we had a program which could solve the halting problem, we could ask it about itself and program it to halt if it won't ever halt and run forever if it will halt. And that's a contradiction. And the only escape from that contradiction is that there's no such program. So, good news. And by the way, I just want to point out that you might think, oh, well, why are we so impressed with this Turing guy? I mean, besides fighting the Nazis. So, I mean, you know, is that the whole proof? Well, keep in mind that when Turing and Gödel were doing their work, they didn't have these high-level concepts like, oh, if I could solve the halting problem, I could use that as a subroutine, and I could feed a program to itself. Right? In most of mathematics, you don't get to feed things to themselves. There are numbers. There are functions that act on numbers and return other numbers. There are things like the derivative, which act on functions and return other functions, but this is a strictly stratified universe. There are no loops in this universe. But, you know, programs are both things that run and act on things, and they are strings. They are source codes that you're text editor or compiler work on. So you really can feed them to themselves, and that's profound. That's something which didn't really exist in mathematics before the 20th century. So, you know, this little kind of diagonal argument, this little paradox, if you will, Turing and also Gödel had to do this sort of in machine language from scratch, without these high-level concepts, and it was really due to them that we now can say, oh, feed it to itself and ask it what it would do. All right, so the halting problem is undecidable. It is, in some sense, just outside the realm of everything which is computable in some finite time, and then making that more quantitative and asking how much can we do with a given amount of memory, and how much can we do if we can verify solutions, and so on. This gives this lovely complexity hierarchy, which is a way to draw qualitative distinctions between different problems and tell us what kind of computation and how much, polynomial or exponential and so on, we need to solve them. And so theoretical computer science is really about drawing these distinctions between problems based on their mathematical structure. Now, how do we prove that a problem is hard? We do what computer scientists call reductions, which is a kind of not the best term. But in general, we prove that a problem is hard because we can build a computer out of it, right? You know that it's hard to predict in general what semiconductors and electrons do because our computers are built out of them. So in the same way, suppose I want to ask, is it hard to solve little tiling puzzles like this, or even a simpler puzzle where I want to know whether a certain region can be filled with copies of these two tiles, a little elbow, a tromino, and a little 2x2 thing. Well, here's a proof that that's potentially hard, because you can design these wires in which the orientation of the tromino carries a bit, and after a little bit of doodling, you find various junctions which act like AND and OR and NOT gates, and that means that telling whether a region can be tiled is tantamount to telling whether it's possible to give a Boolean circuit logical inputs so that its output will be true, which is one of the classic NP-complete problems, which we believe takes exponential time. Which is nice, because we know in our hearts that solving puzzles like this is tricky, even though notice that once you see the solution, you can instantly tell it is a solution. That's exactly what NP is about. All right. Here is another construction of a computer. I hope you can see it. This is a Turing machine made by a very clever person with a lot of time on his hands out of the game of life. And so all these little gliders, I'm sorry I don't have this animated for you, send signals to each other. Here is the head of the Turing machine. Here is the tape of the Turing machine. Oh my God. Well, anyway, so this shows, this could be programmed, for instance, for the entire thing to disappear, or perhaps to turn on a certain cell in the lattice if this Turing machine ever halts, therefore telling what a game of life configuration will eventually do is as hard as the halting problem and undecidable. You may remember, if the cellular automaton aficionados will know rule 110. This is a one-dimensional cellular automaton. Time is going downwards. And you can see, and you know, Jim Crutchfield worked a lot on kind of filtering space-time diagrams like this to see various particles moving around. Happily, your visual cortex does this too. You can see that these various patterns and domain walls between them kind of can move and collide, and some very clever people figured out how to simulate a Turing machine with those, and therefore even this one-dimensional cellular automaton is computationally universal. I just want to point out a case where you can't build a computer, something which is more analogous to the harmonic oscillator, where you don't need to integrate over all the intervening time. This might look complicated, but it is actually just addition mod 2. Each cell is just the sum mod 2, or the parity of its previous ones, the ones above it, to the left and right. And so if you've ever taken a course in partial differential equations, you know that, oh, all I need to do is figure out what's the result of a single one in the initial condition. Well, it's a mod 2 Pascal's triangle, which is this pretty fractal. And then all I need to do is add up the contributions from all the ones in the initial condition, just like you would do with the heat equation or the wave equation. And so, you know, this is a linear system. It's linear mod 2, but it's linear. And so it's quite easy to take an initial condition and quickly compute what the state is down here. There's simply no need to do the simulation. So for this cellular automaton, there is a shortcut because it's not capable of computation. All right, so what if we want to think about the computation in continuous dynamical systems? So computers that have continuous states and perhaps which move in continuous time rather than discrete states. And of course, there's a lovely history of this. This is a tide predicting computer made by Lord Kelvin. This is a tide predicting computer which was in use up into the 1970s in this country. This is a hydrodynamic computer which was used well into the late 20th century in the Soviet Union to integrate differential equations and to do like economic modeling. So perhaps this was used for a little central planning. And I really want someone to write a novel, and maybe somebody already did, about an alternate world in which the transistor was never invented. You may know that there were attempts to build microfluidic computers with tiny channels of fluid moving down them. And, you know, maybe there's some world in which lots of people go to university and learn how to build mechanical devices with maybe tiny gears and pulleys and so on that do complicated computations. Yes, David.
Brenda Rubenstein in Brown Chemistry Department, she's been working on what they have is thousands of little teeny chemical vials that do different parts of a computation, and they actually feed them into one another in the appropriate way to actually take all these distinct chemical reaction networks and combine them to do an arbitrary computer.
So I don't know that work. That sounds really cool. I mean, my friend Darko Stefanovic at UNM was involved in making a tic-tac-toe playing computer out of DNA, but that was still using continuous things to simulate Boolean things. In other words, the states were still really Boolean, like high or low concentrations. So I think the interesting thing is, when are you actually using the continuum to record information in some sense? Now, during my postdoc here, I got very interested in this because unlike discrete computation, where we really have a very firm notion of what is computable, in analog computation, it's fair to say that we don't really have a model which quite seems to nail it. We have multiple models of analog computation which can disagree with each other and which have kind of different motivations, because after all, what do we mean? Do we mean kind of an idealized analog device that could be built in a perfectly Newtonian universe? Do we mean a device that we could actually build in our universe? What do we mean? So if you actually go back to Turing's original work, he phrased it in terms of real numbers. And he defined a number as computable if there's a discrete computer, a Turing machine, which if you ask it for the first n digits can produce the first n digits, like pi. Well, I mean, you can then ask lots of questions about how much time or memory does it take, but this feels a little bit, you know, if you wanted to study analog computation, if I jump back and say, oh, well, do I have a digital computer which can approximate your real number? It feels like, oh, that kind of wasn't what I meant, right? And so, I don't know. It's a simulation of the analog with the digital. So is there some way to talk about computation which is more native to analog things? Hmm. So I kind of already said this. I should mention that in addition to the Church-Turing thesis, there's also, as many of you know, the physical Church-Turing thesis, which is that any device we could actually build in our world with our laws of physics can be simulated with a Turing machine. And, you know, Feynman is famous for saying that, well, for a couple of things, but he also said that a finite volume of space-time and a finite amount of, a finite amount of time and a finite amount of space somehow is only doing a finite amount of information processing inside it. And that's not obvious, right? That's really not obvious. I mean, it could be that space-time is continuous even at the smallest scales. Yes, I know the Planck scale, something, something. We don't know what happens down there. So it's an interesting claim. And
why did he claim that?
Because he believed it.
So can I ask a question?
Yeah.
So what do you think of the physical Church-Turing thesis?
I think it's probably true.
Probably.
Well,
I think it's probably not true.
Okay. Good. Well, we should talk. Yeah, I think that there are, this is partly why I got interested in analog computation. And as we'll see, I think the kind of things we did with analog computation do not contradict the physical Church-Turing thesis, even though they might contradict it in an idealized world where real numbers have infinite precision and can be measured to infinite precision.
That's what I was going to say, is it practical or impractical? And that's probably why you're right. But I'm just, as a chemist, and I want to make a chemical computer, I'm just like, when do I lose the precision? But this is something for later.
Yeah, but we're not necessarily... Feynman wasn't saying practical. I mean, he really meant, what can the universe do? Not just, what can we do with twiddling the universe? So, I mean, I think it's an interesting question. There are some attempts to create hypercomputation with closed time-like loops, and you leave your grad students in orbit around a black hole and then fall in, and you tell them to maintain a priesthood and send you the answer if they ever get one, and then turn on your engines, and I don't know. Yes.
So maybe I'm sort of being very sort of simple about this, but when I walk across the room, I pass through an uncountable number of uncomputable numbers.
Oh yes, didn't some Greek mention this?
I think he was Hungarian, but most real numbers are uncomputable.
Right. So
how do I square that with, and not only are they, it's uncomputable, I can transfer one uncomputable number and transform it into another one. I can do information processing on the uncomputables. So how do I square that with the physical Church-Turing thesis?
I
assume the world is described by a continuum. How do you
It is described by a continuum.
Well, you don't know that.
Yeah.
Okay, this is a great conversation, which I don't want to eat into my precious time.
You don't know that.
If it's not, then the question becomes trivial.
Right, but notice, okay.
Let's just not make the question trivial. Let's imagine we live in a continuous universe, in which case this becomes an issue, right?
Exactly. But, for instance, one second. So imagine we have our harmonic oscillator, and that its frequency is exactly 1 or pi or whatever, 2 pi, that the answer is cosine of t. Well, if t is uncomputable, cosine of t is also uncomputable.
Mm-hmm.
But that's cheating, right? I mean, putting in an uncomputable input and then saying, oh, look, the output is uncomputable, so it's doing something uncomputable, that's you're just getting back out what you put in. So I would say that even in a continuous world, if you're walking from there to there, at computable times, you're at computable places.
Yes.
So let's talk about that more afterward.
I would love to.
Okay, Michael.
Oh.
But be aware that I have too many slides, and so if I run out of time, I will blame you, not myself.
I mean, I just want to say, if when you hit an uncomputable molecule that is in an uncomputable place, the question is like, how long will it take till what digit of that number will have an effect, right? So could be that the thousands digit will have an effect only after 3 years.
Yeah, I mean, yes. I mean, Purell and Richards had this thing where they said that they very carefully constructed computable initial conditions for the wave equation that hid stranger and stranger things in the higher and higher frequency parts of the initial condition so that the final state was uncomputable. Now, that's tricky. And so I think what Feynman would say about that is that at some point, we can use fancy physics words like the ultraviolet catastrophe or something. At some point, you just cannot access really, really high really, really high frequency aspects of space-time. You can't create states that in that fine-grained way, and you can't measure states in that fine-grained way. But exactly, this is exactly the set of questions that I was interested in. By the way, let me quickly mention that there's something which we don't believe is true, which is that what physical systems can do in polynomial time is what a Turing machine can do in polynomial time. Here, we think that you need to amend that with what a quantum computer can do in polynomial time. So quantum computing, we think, doesn't change what is computable, but it does change how fast you can do it. Okay, anyway, so let me just, and I know some of you know this history, but it's really fun history. So, you know, again, we're back in the early 20th century, and people are using these beautiful mechanical devices that integrate things, like it will build up and it will compute the integral of how much some other device has rotated. And it can do multiplication and sort of mechanical amplification. I think these are beautiful machines. So Vannevar Bush, who's also largely responsible for creating the National Science Foundation, had this thing called a differential analyzer, which could do these sorts of things. And so it's essentially a set of circuits with adders, multipliers, and integrators. So Claude Shannon thought about this and pointed out that the set of functions it computes is a large, very lovely set of functions. They're called differentially algebraic functions, and they're functions that are the solutions to differential equations, which are polynomials in the different derivatives of the function. It's a lovely class of functions. It's closed under composition. If f is in this class and g is in this class, then so is f of g. It has many other closure properties as well. Oddly enough, there are some things it doesn't include. It does not include the gamma function. And this is a theorem. So it's like, the gamma function is a continuous generalization of the factorial. It is itself writable as an integral, but it is not the solution to a polynomial differential equation. So you might think, okay, that seems a bit unfair, but all right. But the point is, here's a model of a machine and a result about what that machine can do, which is, you know, that sort of answers the question about that model. Now, another model, which appeared in the late 20th century by Blum, Shub, and Smale, is not really trying to model physical systems or mechanical things. It's trying to model scientific computation. Because when lots of people, including lots of numerically minded people as opposed to digitally minded people, when they think about algorithms, they think about the variables as real numbers. They don't pay that much attention to the fact that they're actually floats or doubles or something, because that just sort of gets in the way in many cases of thinking about, say, gradient descent. How many steps of gradient descent do you need to do? You should really regard your variables and your operations as being real valued. So, you know, they wrote down, okay, suppose you have a flowchart or a random access machine, whatever, with these basic operations, basic arithmetic, what can it do? One interesting thing about their things, though, is they can do branching on, for instance, is x bigger than zero? So in this model, you can carry out discontinuous things. You can carry out step functions. And maybe that's okay, but you might also say, well, that sounds a bit unphysical. What if x is really, really, really small? How can I tell whether it's positive or just zero? But I think, you know, as a model of scientific computation, it's fine, but it's sort of a different flavor with a different purpose. So I tossed one hat in the ring on this because I really liked recursion theory. This is an early 20th century picture of computable functions, which is also equivalent to Turing machines, called partial recursive functions. And I like the flavor of this one. You start with kind of atoms of very simple functions. And here I'm going to do functions on the natural numbers, n, the integers. We're going to start with the number zero. Feels like you ought to be able to compute zero. And the successor function, which takes its input and adds one to it. Those will be our atoms. And then what we can do is build up more and more functions out of those in a way which we now would view as programming. But back then, people didn't call it that. So one is to compose two functions. I'll let you compose two functions in the class and add that to the class. One is called primitive recursion, which we now call a for loop. So what this does is, if I already have a way to take the value of a function at one number and figure out what the value should be at the next number in terms of the previous values, I will henceforth call that a computable function. So, for instance, by iterating adding one, I can do addition. By iterating addition, I can do multiplication, and so on. And I call this a for loop because even though I've written it in this way, what we would really do is say, oh, well, for y equals 0 up to the y you wanted, and just do this that many times. Then there's one kind of slightly mysterious thing in partial recursive functions, which is historically, I was telling Gulchi not to worry about what people call things historically. Who cares what people called things? Many of them were wrong. It's called minimization, but it shouldn't be called that. It should be called root finding or something. If you have a function in your class, say of two variables, x and y, this will find the smallest y. If you give it x, it will find the smallest y such that f of x comma y is 0. Okay. Now, first of all, this is mysterious for two reasons. Like, what if that y is very large? How do you find it? So this is a while loop instead of a for loop. So this will just start with y equals 0 and just look at larger and larger y. And if it ever finds one, it will give you that. But if there is no such y, it will never halt. In which case, we say that this function is undefined, which is why these are partial recursive functions. And so you already see here something vaguely like the halting problem. And indeed, telling whether one of these functions is defined or not is exactly the halting problem. That's a for loop, that's a while loop. OK, so let's do this with the reals instead of the natural numbers. So let's start instead with just 0 and 1. I'm not even going to give you the identity function, because I can get that by integrating the number 1. OK? But you can see I was having fun. We're going to keep composition the way it was. But now this for loop of iterating will become a continuous sort of dynamical system, which is continuously moving y from 0 up to the y you were interested in. And so that will, you know, do that. So, let's keep this root finding thing, except now that we're searching over the reals, which is maybe even more questionable than searching over all the integers. But, that'd be fun. So as you can imagine, this system is a bit too powerful, right? I mean, it's certainly not a physical thing to do, to say, oh, now you give me a function, I will instantly tell you whether there's any place over all of the reals where it's 0. That's worse than the halting problem. And indeed, with this system, you can do all sorts of even more uncomputable things that live up in places that hardly anyone thinks about, called the arithmetical and analytical hierarchies. Manuel Campagnolo, I don't know if any of you knew him. He's now in Lisbon. He was here for part of his graduate career and worked on a number of extensions of this. All right, so I'm not saying that was the right model either. That was just my little contribution. But it is a highly unphysical model, which computes too many things. Yes, Simon.
All right, just briefly, is that just the continuous real functions, or is it that actually gets really weird?
With this root finding, you can create discontinuities. Yeah, exactly. All right, so there are kind of two problems here if we're trying to think about what can analog systems do. One is that in continuous time, you can cheat like this, right? This is meant to look a little bit like Thompson's lamp, where you flick it on and then off, and then half a second later on, and a quarter second later off or on. And anyway, you rattle back and forth at times which all converge somewhere. So with this kind of cheating, you can squeeze an infinite amount of computation into a finite amount of time. So one question is there, you know, how do we prevent that in a well-defined way? Just recently, there was a very nice result that said, well, if you use arc length as your measure of time, this is the right idea, right? This is a very nice idea. So it certainly catches us here. You might worry, well, maybe if I made the wiggles smaller quickly enough. But if that was the solution to a differential equation, they were able to show that some other variable has to be exploding to make those tinier and tinier wiggles. So I think this is a very satisfying result. And so what they showed specifically is that what Shannon's general purpose analog computer can do in a polynomial arc length is equivalent to digital polynomial time. So that's a very kind of satisfying marriage of the two. The other problem is, if I'm going to use analog systems to solve discrete problems, well, I need an interface. I need some way to put a discrete thing like a string of bits into the initial condition of my analog device, my continuous dynamical system, and I need some way to read the result back out. And then you have to ask, well, what? How are we allowed to do that, right? You can cheat here too. If you give me an arbitrary way to map strings into real numbers, well, of course, I could do the entire computation just in that interface, and that would clearly not be kosher. So one way to do this is maybe with kind of simple iterated functions. As you can see, maybe if we start with zero and then divide by two or divide by two and add a half, we will put our string into the real number in binary. So, but maybe there are other maps that would do that. Now, this is closely related to something in dynamical systems called symbolic dynamics. We're really, this is so retro, this talk. I mean, like somebody should turn on some Rolling Stones or ABBA or something. Please, not ABBA. Okay, so here's this classic one-humped map. This is a diagram of many iterates of this map. I could ask, well, suppose I divide the interval into left and right, and every time you're on the left side, I write down a zero, and every time you're on the right side, I write down a one. Then I could ask, well, what sequences can actually happen? And if the height of this map is, if it stretches over the entire interval, then any sequence can happen, because at every step we're taking the entire thing and stretching it over the entire thing. And by working backwards, you can kind of see that any sequence you like will occur. But there are these other interesting places, such as at the transition to chaos, where the set of sequences that you can have is pretty cool, actually, with an intermediate level of computational complexity. Jim worked on this too. So it turns out that, for instance, the sequence that the chaotic attractor follows is this cool scale-free thing. Like if you've heard of Morse 2E sequences, it's one of these things where you get it by repeatedly replacing ones with one zeros and zeros with one ones, and this creates this kind of fractal thing where each half is the same as the previous half except for the last bit. And you know, reading one of these sequences and telling whether, or reading a sequence and telling whether it could occur in here, it's kind of an interesting intermediate computational problem. It's, if you are a fan of the Chomsky hierarchy, it's not a regular language, it's not a context-free language, it's, you know, a bit above that. Okay, so the next thing I want to tell you about is this thing by Steve Smale, who showed that many naturally occurring, in some sense, dynamical systems, including many nonlinear oscillators, have inside them, in their phase space, a little two-dimensional region, which is doing something like what I just showed you before. It's being stretched and then folded over itself, kind of like making phyllo dough or taffy. And it has a fixed set in it, which is a nice Cantor set. And so if we sort of digitize this and define, say which half are you in, but do that both horizontally and vertically, well, then you get this very interesting iteration where, for instance, this rectangle will go there. And if you write this out, it's a little bit complicated because of the flipping, but you can see that the vertical direction is being stretched at every step. So that's going to reveal new bits of the y-coordinate and double, or the way I've drawn this, triple the vertical distance between things at each step. So you can see that it's chaotic. And in fact, his motivation was to use the appearance of this animal inside nonlinear oscillators to prove that they are chaotic. And indeed, generically chaotic, because once this thing is there, it remains there if you apply a small perturbation. Now, but what I want you to imagine is, well, how do you reveal a new bit of a number in binary? You multiply it by 2, and you shift its binary sequence up so that those distant bits corresponding to small differences are moving up toward the decimal or binary point. Meanwhile, X is getting squeezed, so it looks as if X's binary sequence is being shifted to the right, although sometimes the first thing will be a 0 and sometimes it will be a 1, depending on where it was. Well, now, and now this is my PhD thesis, which in retrospect seems utterly trivial. In fact, I want to tell you that I got my PhD by a 2 out of 3 vote of my thesis committee, which I claim is the ideal fraction of a thesis committee. Member number 3 said, this is very nice, but it's not physics. Okay. If one sequence is being shifted up and the other is being shifted down, if we flip them around and put them head to tail, then it's doing something like this, or like that. And you could view that instead as taking the little dot and moving it this way, or moving it that way, starting to look like a Turing machine. And I had just read Gödel, Escher, Bach, and wow, okay. So here's a simpler version where we don't flip anything over. Now the binary digits really are just getting shifted. So here's a Turing machine. Depending on where you are in this map, which includes what the state of the head of the Turing machine is, you either shift left or shift right, which means you either stretch vertically or horizontally. And then where you go gets put somewhere else, which can correspond to writing a new symbol on the tape of the Turing machine or shifting to a new state of the Turing machine. So there you go. And this particular Turing machine is computationally universal. And so given an initial point, even a rational initial point, even a dyadic rational initial point, which has zeros in its binary sequence after a finite point, it is undecidable to tell if I iterate this map whether it will ever fall into a particular open set, because that could correspond to halting, whether it will ever return to where it began, making it a periodic point. Again, this sounds fancier than it is, but even telling whether its eventual trajectory is chaotic is undecidable, because if the thing halts, I toss it into a little chaotic thing where it keeps doing that for the rest of time. A couple of people had this idea around the same time, and so I'm lucky that I published first. So this is a low-dimensional dynamical system which is capable of universal computation. Now, the reason I got invited to Barcelona is that some very clever people have figured out how to embed this kind of map as a flow, a fluid flow, so that every time you go around, you do another step of the map. And they did that in multiple contexts. First you have to smooth this thing out, of course, to make it continuous. But you can do that easily because we had these gaps between the blocks in our Cantor set. And then they designed clever metrics in, for instance, three-dimensional space, clever curved manifolds, if you like, so that fluid moving incompressibly on that manifold will carry out this computation. So figuring out where a particle will go in this space is undecidable. Great. So now I want to show you one other attempt to marry the continuous with the discrete. In 93, so when I first got here, my first 2 years of my postdoc were not very successful. I didn't really know what to do. I didn't really have any mentorship here. I kind of drifted. I got into politics, Luckily, the Institute, including Jim at one point, took pity on me and allowed my career to continue. God only knows what gutter I'd be in now otherwise.
You're welcome.
What?
You're welcome.
Thank you. Eventually Ellen Goldberg said, you got to get out of here. And then I applied for a job at UNM, and the first year I didn't even get an interview. And then the second year I got the job because the person they really wanted didn't take it. So, I mention this because I think it's important for us all to realize how contingent life paths and careers can be. But in 93, when half of you were not born, I got really interested in whether it was possible to get three equal masses in Newtonian gravity to chase each other around a figure eight. I just thought this was a nice question, but I also liked it because my advisor, Philip Holmes, had looked at topological classifications of periodic orbits in, say, three-dimensional space by asking, are these orbits knotted? Or are multiple periodic orbits braided around each other? Which I thought was lovely. So I thought, okay, well, wouldn't it be nice if three masses could do this, where on the right you see a kind of space-time thing drawn out, and you can see it's the classic three-strand braid. And this is a bona fide orbit of Newton's equations. And in fact, I'm going to mention that in Cixin Liu's novel, The Three-Body Problem, he mentions the trisolarans who live in a solar system of this kind. There is a footnote which somewhat damagingly to my ego does not mention me. It rather mentions the Alain Chansonnet and Richard Montgomery, who completely independently of my work in 2000 proved rigorously, which I did not do, I only found it numerically, that this orbit exists. This orbit is even dynamically stable. So if you perturb it slightly, it doesn't immediately fly away. It does various kind of gentle rotations and so on, but it is stable to small enough perturbations. So someone estimated that there might be one of these in the universe. There's that book. Now, you might wonder, how did I find this, right? Because obviously, if you just try different initial conditions, different initial positions and momenta, this is not going to work. There are, in fact, very sophisticated methods in so-called Hamiltonian systems with conservation of energy, to find things like periodic orbits, but I didn't know these methods. So I did something called the principle of least action. So this is something that we usually save for the third year of physics, which is too bad. It turns out that instead of F equals ma and, you know, sort of integrating things forward, there's a completely different way to think about Newtonian physics, which also generalizes to many other things, including relativistic and quantum mechanics, called the principle of least action. So this L, the curly L, is called the Lagrangian, and it is the kinetic energy, K, minus the potential energy, V. And it turns out that the integral of this over time is something which is, well, actually, it's not generally minimized. It's often some sort of saddle point. But it is a stationary point in the space of trajectories. Could be a minimum, could be a maximum, could be a saddle. But sometimes it's a minimum. So what I did was I just made up a totally fictional trajectory that had the structure I wanted. It was literally these two things do that in circular arcs, and then these two things do that in circular arcs, and so on. And this was on a Macintosh writing in Pascal, and I just discretized it very naively. And then I just did gradient descent, and it turned from some, you know, fictional thing into a genuine trajectory of Newton's equations. So lots of people have done, there's Chansonnet and Montgomery, and lots of people have done much better and more precise versions of this since me. There were also, there's a lot of fun, once you start looking for these things, they're all over the place. One which actually dates back to the 70s is this thing, which does this wonderful, you know, isn't that cool? This thing goes around, and those things go up and down and left and right, and this braid is a little bit different. You can see that the green one goes around them both. So what I was trying to do here was classify different periodic orbits topologically with these different braid types. So there's a very nice thing called the braid group, and it has a lovely algebraic properties. So kind of analogous to symbolic dynamics, where we mapped bit strings to real numbers in the horseshoe map or the unimodal map or those Turing machine maps, This was a kind of attempt to do something similar. This one is also stable, as it turns out. So you could ask, well, in analogy with symbolic dynamics, where we ask, well, which strings are possible? You could ask, which braids are possible? One cute fact is that if the potential energy goes like 1 over r squared instead of 1 over r, which would mean the force would go like 1 over r cubed instead of 1 over r squared, this is what gravity would be like in a four-dimensional universe, for instance, then all braids are possible. And the reason is that what happens as you start with a fictional thing and try to minimize the action, well, what could go wrong? Something could fly off to infinity. But good news, the action of anything that flies off to infinity is infinite. So if you're minimizing the action, that's not going to happen. The other thing that could happen is you could break your linking, your braid, by having the trajectories do that. But they would have to pass through a collision to do that. And if gravity goes like 1 over r cubed, you compute the action of a collision, the integral diverges, and that's infinite too. So in other words, if gravity falls off that sharply, or more so with distance, then absolutely any topology is possible. But I think for other values, it's a little tricky. I mean, people have done this thing of how, if you fall in from very far away to something massive, how much do you wind around it before going back out somewhere far away? In Newtonian gravity, you go all the way around, like a comet, right? Because the orbits are elliptical. But if gravity were less dependent on distance, it would do something like that, not going all the way around. And if it's more dependent on distance, it goes more than all the way around and does something like that. And at 1 over r cubed, it can go in and go around for as many times as you want and then come back out, which is why all braids are possible. So you could probably use these considerations to figure out some things. And you can do lovely things in higher dimensions too. I did these with Michael Nauenberg. Anyway.
So all of these things have equal mass and they're all in the result?
Yeah, but a lot of these things you can make the masses a little bit unequal and still do them.
And the initial conditions are just set at value 0?
No, they're not a set of value 0. Actually, I'm not sure if we know that. What we know is that it's linearly stable, right? But it's a Hamiltonian system, so that means eigenvalues are on the unit circle in the complex plane, and that doesn't necessarily tell you what will happen at long times.
But from the way you found them, it seems to be quite stable.
Well, but I didn't find it by evolving in real time. I found it by evolving in trajectory space. But yes, I mean, the very fact that it then worked on a digital computer suggests that it's kind of stable because digital computers make mistakes. But of course, I didn't run it forever. Okay, anyway. So I just want to finish up here. There is, I think, a common dichotomy, which is often incorrect, where we assume that problems are either easy. I'm distracting you with all this text. I just told someone not to put so much text on their slides. So we often assume that a problem is either easy or maybe computationally universal. Okay, and in fact, I think Wolfram even at one point said he believed this about cellular automata. They can either simulate Turing machines or they're very simple. And in fact, we know in theoretical computer science that there are problems in between. So for instance, we know that if P and NP are different, which we don't quite know, but let's assume that, if P and NP are different, there are problems which are outside P. They cannot be solved in polynomial time, but they are not NP complete. In other words, or maybe a better example, we do know for sure that there are problems which are not computable, but which are not Turing universal either. In other words, even if you could solve these problems by magic, you still couldn't solve the halting problem. Okay? I think this is really profound and not well appreciated. And so how could a problem be hard but not universal? One way is to kind of build them with a fancy diagonal argument that prevents them from being universal. At the same time, it makes them hard, but that's not a kind of, that doesn't give a kind of naturally occurring problem. One second, David, can we, I'm almost done, so can we do this at the end?
Yeah, I guess
so. Okay. So another reason why this could be the case is that something about their structure is tricky, but in a kind of specific way that doesn't seem to have the general ability to express any other computational problem. So for instance, we think factoring is like this. So we pretty much know that factoring is not NP-complete, but as far as we can tell, it's not NP either. Of course, if it turned out tomorrow to be in polynomial time, nothing much would happen. The banking system would collapse, but there wouldn't be any major consequences mathematically. So factoring appears to be hard, but not in so general way that you can build a computer out of it, if you know what I mean. Another one of my favorite problems like this is graph isomorphism. Due to some very recent work of Lassi Babai, we know it is almost polynomial time. It's like, you know, the number of vertices to a power of the logarithm, which is just a bit more than n to a constant. But there are still n factorial potential ways to map n vertices here to n vertices there. And so we still don't have a fully polynomial time algorithm that works in every case. But it certainly does not seem to have the general property that would make it NP complete. Interestingly enough, asking whether one graph has a subgraph isomorphic to another is NP complete, but comparing this entire graph to that entire graph is not. So just to finish, there are lots of cellular automata, and every once in a while I toy with the idea of thinking about them again, and I think, no, I'm too old now. This is cellular automata in rule 30. And, you know, it's a bit nonlinear. It's, you take the thing on the left and exclusive OR it with the OR of the two things on the right. So it's a sort of a quadratic rule, and it does stuff. And I am very sure that you cannot build a Turing machine out of this rule. I'm also skeptical that there is a fast algorithm which computes this row of this table without doing the simulation in between. So it seems to be hard, but in kind of a messy way. David Griffith and I looked at something called Life Without Death, which is the game of life where nothing ever turns off. We found some initial conditions that send signals in a controlled way that you can use to compute, and other initial conditions that do things like that, which it looks tricky. It also looks very uncontrolled, very hard to channel to send information from here to there and do a logical operation on it. So my guess is that a lot of natural systems are in this middle messy range. So here is a very classic chaotic map. It's so classic, it's called the standard map. It's very rich and complicated. It has all sorts of periodic orbits, these things called KAM tori, but you can leak out of them and then spend time at another one and move around intermittently all over the place. I would be stunned if there were any computational way to compute the future state. I'll give you infinite precision for free. I would still be stunned if there was any way to compute future states without actually iterating step by step and simulating the entire intervening history. But I would be even more stunned if you could build a Turing machine in this map, out of this map. So I think it's one of these messy things. And I'll just end and with that, and I'll say that, you know, I think the computational lens, or some people call the algorithmic lens, like the complex systems lens, or the physics lens, or the network lens, or the economics lens, it is an interesting way to look at things. You can look at anything with it, just like all of those lenses can look at anything. And it may make certain aspects of that system clearer and others less clear. So I think it's a good question to ask what it can tell us about natural systems. And Gulchi mentioned this too. You know, do cells compute? is that the right metaphor for what they do? Do markets compute? Is that the right word? You know, that's sort of, that's putting value on the information processing they're doing and less on all the other things they're doing. People like David are trying to, and Artemy are trying to merge more computation and thermodynamics. No, but saying that something computes is privileging a particular aspect of its behavior, the same way that, say, the network lens privileges sort of usually two-way interactions between agents that are operating on a roughly equal level. Sometimes that's an informative lens, sometimes less so. I like the picture that what we do is having all these lenses overlap and looking through whichever one we like and throwing it away if it doesn't seem to help and switching to a different one. So thank you very much. David.
Yeah, so quick thing, many people here indicated they would love to have follow-on discussions, but we try to schedule a time for that.
How did they indicate that? We've all been sitting here. Did they tweet or something?
I heard people say that let's talk about this idea.
Oh, okay. I thought that was mostly me trying to avoid talking about it now. But yes, I'd be happy to.
Discussion between me and you could be fine.
I'd be happy to talk.
I'm happy to join.
Yeah.
Okay, yeah.
It could be fun. There's a lot of practice.
Yeah. That's kind of the vibe.
David was right.
Yeah.
Okay. Yes.
So how about this? If anybody who's interested, email me by the end of the day, and I don't know, I'll figure out Doodle or Java or something.
First half of next week.
Yeah. Sometime for next week, though there's another interesting workshop going on. Anyway. Okay, cool. So contact me. Point number two, you're going back a couple of slides. What is computation? It's a bit of a, how generic is computation? You had just water compute and so on. Yeah. Bingo, that one. As a bit of a kind of a shout out with some people at the Complexity Science Hub in Vienna, I'm putting on a workshop for a week in Austria in October on exactly this issue that also some of the people that Chris was mentioning. We have no more travel funds, but many folks are gonna be zooming in, like Josh Grotschow, for example. So the more people that can be involved in this, the better. So please contact me about that. And I have a question for you. You were using the word hard at the very end, and I wasn't quite sure, did you mean things like NP, did you mean what Wolfram called computationally irreducible? Are those actually the same and I just am clueless?
No, I think, so I was using hard in a fairly hand-wavy way on purpose because what it means is a little bit different depending on the system. So, John Macta and I were interested in the question, doing these simulations of a cellular automaton, well, you can do that in polynomial time if you want to compute a CA of polynomial size for polynomial time. It's not that the simulation is incredibly hard to do. But then you could ask, well, can we do something even faster? So below NP and P, below P is something called NC, which stands for Nick's class. Nick's class is the set of things which we can highly parallelize. And in other words, that if you have a polynomial number of processors, exponentially many processors can do too much. So let's limit the polynomial number, the number of processors to a polynomial, and then ask what could they do in log time or log squared time. So then there are certain problems that are called p-complete, which because we believe that p and nc are not the same, we believe that they cannot be parallelized. In other words, just as we believe that some problems really do require exhaustive search, that's sort of what it means to think that P and NP are different. We believe that there are some, if you will, dynamical systems that are inherently sequential. You have to do the first step to see what happens at the next step. People make the joke is that if you invite 10 friends over, it doesn't mean you can cook dinner in 1/10 of the time. Certain things have to be done after other things. So, the question of is something kind of analogous to, is a dynamical system integrable like there's a solution like cosine of t as a, that you don't have to do the numerical integration. That seemed to us a lot like the P versus NC question. So we looked at various physical models and tried to figure out, are they in NC? Are they P complete? Are they somewhere in between and so on?
So that's what you meant rather than NP, which I couldn't quite see how it could be NP for the reasons you said. Chaotic for them.
I mean, even in cellular automata, computing a future state is in P, but we could ask, can we do even better?
Yeah. Okay.
Computing predecessor states is NP complete. But maybe for some CA rules, that's easier than that. So, you know, I agree with the background of your question that there's no single hard or easy. It depends on what kind of question you're trying to ask. You know, if I give you a cellular automaton on some finite space and ask, will it ever return to its initial state? That could take exponential time. But if it's a fixed size, that problem can be solved in a polynomial amount of space. So that puts us in the P space class, which is above NP. So, you know, the real question is, what question are you asking? It's not that systems are complex or simple or easy or hard. It's questions about them are easy or hard.
So I know people have talked about, tried to define chaos for CAs. Do you know if any of those things are defined as chaotic? Or they fall as an example of what you're saying or not?
Well, so this one that I said is easy, the linear rule, not only is it easy, it is highly chaotic. In fact, it's maximally chaotic. So it's a little bit, it is indeed pretty much the parity function that Gulchay talked about. It, you know, if I flip a bit over here, that bit is guaranteed to come along at the speed of light, mm-hmm. and flip other bits. So I think, you know, this, and let me say about my Turing maps, well, the horseshoe map, Snell's horseshoe, is chaotic because it's always stretching in one direction. The Turing machine maps, an interesting Turing machine is going to move left roughly as often as it moves right, because to do a non-trivial calculation, it has to revisit the certain points on the tape many, many times. If it cruises off in one direction, then it is only actually going to visit places a finite number of times, in which case, in some sense, it's going to be more like a finite state machine. So I'm not going for the edge of chaos thing here, but I do want to say that the most chaotic things are often not the ones capable of computation. And the things that are doing complicated computation are often not that chaotic, maybe marginally chaotic in the sense that if I flip a bit over here, that will eventually affect the Turing machine when it gets that far on the tape, but it won't affect it. It won't cruise over to it linearly, which, once we talk about the metric, means that the effect of that flip will not grow exponentially. It will grow at some slower, according to some slower function. Yes, yes, and then Simon, and then.
So, at a certain point, you mentioned quantum computers. And so I was wondering if you can kind of expand a little bit more where quantum computers are in this broad picture of analog digital.
Sure. So, The current, most of the time now when we talk about quantum computers, we mean something a lot like a digital computer, except that the bits can be in these superpositions, they can be entangled with each other, and then we have basic operations that are, they're not just the Boolean operations because they can rotate these continuous states in their state space. And so what that model of computation can do is believed to be incomparable with NP, neither contained in it nor containing it. And that's interesting. So in other words, we don't think that quantum computers can solve NP-complete problems in polynomial time. They can achieve a significant speed up, but not take an exponential search all the way down to a polynomial. But we also think that there are things that quantum computers can do which a classical computer could not even verify, the way that you can instantly look at the solution to this problem and tell that it's a solution. So that means that there are things quantum computers can do that are outside NP, because NP problems are those where, in some sense, a classical computer, given polynomial time, can efficiently confirm that you got the right answer once it sees the answer you give. That's very interesting. I mean, and so it's, Scott Aronson has done a lot of work on this and written a lot about it. So, you know, and in the popular press, it's often suggested that quantum computers could solve NP complete problems in polynomial time. We don't think that's true. On the other hand, factoring, which is at the heart of public key cryptography, it can do. So we think that those two sets are something like this. They have an intersection. They each have something outside. They're incomparable.
But within
pieces. Yes. What quantum? Yes. So yes, if you go far up into the complexity hierarchy, then they merge. But you have to go quite far up. I mean, classical and quantum merge, and for computability, they merge. So, you know, what one can do in finite time, the other can do in finite time. Yes?
Professor, I wanted to pitch a new research agenda for you. Since you like sneaking sort of up to the boundary, but not crossing it, right? These messy problems. I'm wondering about this phrase, you know, this phrase, Turing tar pit?
Turing tar pit?
Tar pit, yeah. So this
like don't throw me in that tar pit.
Well, it's like they're Turing complete systems, but they're just so crappy to work with. You can't actually do anything with them, right? And I think about like the you know, Conway's Game of Life. Yes, build a computer out of it, but in some ways it's not very well. Like presumably, if you flip one bit, you know, if you light up one block there, the whole thing will collapse, right?
We don't know that. But yes, I mean, all the constructions we have are very fragile.
Yeah.
So like when people talk about, could the game of life ever support life?
Right.
I think there's a similar question. Could there ever be a sort of, you know, membrane which is flexible and can handle shocks from the outside to some extent? And I think, you know, metaphorically, the game of life looks more like the Planck scale than the cellular or even molecular scale.
Yeah, well, I guess my feeling is this: everything is Turing complete, basically, right?
Mm.
It's hard, like a finite state machine with like a counter. Maybe you need two counters. Is Turing complete?
Yes.
Right, but I wouldn't want to write my code in that.
Yes.
Right, and
but you wouldn't want to use a Turing machine to do Turing to complete.
No, that's right.
Yeah.
It's like we're actually surrounded by systems that could actually compute, but never end up doing it for some reason. That actual computation, like the ability to compute is everywhere, but actual computation is maybe much rarer. I guess maybe my pitch, and understanding why objects that potentially could compute never end up doing it seems really interesting.
You mean actual or useful?
Yeah.
I mean, they're computing all the time, but in a way that...
And do you mean actual in a world with clever people who are trying to build things?
Exactly. It's maybe just anthropomorphized. I mean, they can really be doing super useful things. I mean, billiard balls are even, okay, in Sontag's work there.
Well, but... I mean, maybe a better example is this laptop, right? There's a lot of exotic states of matter in this laptop,
right,
that before 100 years ago did not occur in nature anywhere near here.
Mm-hmm.
So, yes, they were invented, carefully manufactured, and built, but they obey the laws of physics.
Mm-hmm.
So, I mean, this is a very, very rare state of matter, but...
It's a rare state. I mean, I guess one of the things that came up is useful computation, right? So computation always relative to a need, presumably, right? There's always some goal state.
That sounds like the economic lens, but go ahead.
Yeah, sure. you know, it's like a slime mold in a petri dish is Turing complete, I'm sure. And yet somehow it's not going to do anything particularly smart.
But
depends on, like Seth has this paper on how it hides your atom. If you look at it correctly, theoretically, so it's got a lot to do with
what?
Like, decompose the state.
Really?
Yeah.
Huh.
If you look at it correctly, it's a simple. So you're right that there is sort of something there, but it's got a lot to do with if I decompose it in the Fourier decomposition or a wavelet decomposition or some other kind of a decomposition, like I would look at the entire spectrum of my hydrogen atom.
But we don't want this to be a subjective matter of how we look at it. I think that's, you know, I want to understand computation in some intrinsic way. But let's do Andres and Michael and then adjourn and continue our discussion offline.
I have a question.
Your comment at the end of the computation.
Oh. Okay. And then Jessica, sorry.
Okay.
Yeah.
Yeah. So,
sorry, I didn't see your hand, Jessica.
Oh, okay. Sorry.
You can go to Jessica.
I can go?
Yeah, sure.
Sure, go.
Thank you. Okay. So I want to push back on your, you know, your point about economic and network lenses and computation just being another one, particularly for biology. So I think about computation in biology as essentially as converting information in the environment to work largely by way of producing ordered states and entropy minimization. And I think in that sense, it's, you know, it does two things. One, it's a powerful framework for actually producing things, and networks, you know, networks aren't that at all. They're just a description of how, you know, the microscale is essentially organized. They don't do anything. The computation does. And so it's much more powerful than those other things you were calling lenses. I think we need to take that seriously. And it may be that it's more important in biology than, you know, in computer science. And maybe that is due to the fact that, and you guys can push back on me if you think this isn't the case, that in biology, the link, although we're nowhere near working it out, the link between energy and information is much tighter. It can't be so easily separated as it perhaps can in computer science. So you have, you know, you can more clearly separate algorithms from the, you know, the infrastructure of computing systems. You can't do that in biology so well. And you could say, and I don't think it's right to say this, you could say that makes computation less relevant in biology, but I just think it's a different kind of, slightly different kind of computation.
I guess my sense is that there are time scales, or if you will, length scales and energy scales, at which the connection between computation and energy is pretty tight, and others at which it's not very tight.
True.
And you know, it sort of depends on which is your limiting feature, right? So this laptop lives in a world where at the end of the day, energy is pretty abundant, but maybe what is maybe what I'm limited by is the amount of memory or the amount of time. And if that's the case, then things look a bit more like computer science.
Mm.
But I think one nice thing about computer science, and I would defend it as a lens, it's a bit more general. I remember Murray complaining that it was only about time, but that's because he never really read about it. You know, at the end of the day, computer science, I would say, is a field where you tell me what your, and I think Gulchi was going for this too, you tell me what the basic operations are you can do, you tell me how much they cost in terms of various resources, and which resources you care about, and then I, or preferably we, will figure out what problems you can solve with those building blocks with that amount of resource. So it's certainly true that in computer science, we talk sort of 80% about time, 15% about memory, and a few percent about other things like communication, energy, you know, the availability of random bits, and so on. But I think that overall, as a lens, I would describe it as that more general, what can you do with these building blocks with this amount of resources? But yes, let's talk more. Okay, Andres and Michael.
Yeah, so I thought your comment about the computational lens was interesting, just because I see the computational lens as being the same as a mathematical lens, yet, I mean, in a real sense, maybe from a different direction.
I would cheerfully say it's a subfield of mathematics. But you know, not everyone would.
But I mean, but there's
a sense in which they are equivalent, but perhaps different perspectives on the same phenomenon. I don't know. But nobody seems to question, or very few people seem to question, the looking at things through the mathematical lens. In fact, mathematics, people even say, is the language in which nature is written and stuff. But you know, you showed all these examples of analog computers, and they all seem really contrived. And so I just wonder, is there any reason for us to think that computation is something fundamental, or is computation something that is idiosyncratic and particular to humans, but that real scientists like chemists, physicists, biologists shouldn't even pay attention to?
Well, so let's see. So first of all, I think we've talked about this, but in a lot of ways, suppose that there were no computers, right? This sociologically, this field might not have appeared.
Yeah.
But it certainly could have, as a part of mathematics. And, you know, of course, especially in the 1800s, there was this big argument between the constructivists or intuitionists and others. And they said that if you prove that something exists just by saying that it would cause a contradiction if it didn't, it doesn't, or at least you haven't proved it. And, you know, we demand constructive proofs. Well, what's a constructive proof? Well, at the time, they weren't very clear on what a constructive proof was, but intuitively, it's some way to actually find the thing or point to it or, you know, iteratively say more and more about it until you know where it is, something like that. So, I mean, I think it's silly to say that non-constructive proofs aren't proofs, but I certainly agree that constructive proofs are often more insightful than non-constructive proofs. You have to sort of understand more about the system. And I feel like computational complexity is, in a way, a kind of fine-grained version of that question. If I can find something in polynomial time, I understand more about its structure than if I need exponential time to find it, and so on. And you know, certainly when we have the reason problems are in P, the reason why there are efficient algorithms is that they have a structure that we can understand and exploit. So I have no problem putting this inside mathematics. I think one interesting sociological issue is that theoretical computer science, as it's constituted, insists on rigor and proof. You can also think in non-rigorous but convincing ways about these questions, including, say, using physics and intuitive and strongly and numerically very convincing calculations, even when you can't prove them. And I think it's a bit unfortunate that the theoretical computer science community mostly keeps anything which isn't a proof at arm's length. Occasionally they say, oh, we're interested in numerical experiment, but mostly they, the sort of the center of mass of that field isn't, the mainstream isn't. You know, but that's the mathematical lens, as you say. If the mathematical lens could be the lens that says, oh, I want to prove something about the system I'm looking at, which is, of course, only one form of knowing things. I think, let's see, yeah. But yes.
I believe that there's something fundamental about the notion of computation and this complexity hierarchy. But, you know, there are some people that...
Oh, right. So, I'm sorry. Yeah, that was a very important question. So what I would say is that I think the fact that all of these models of discrete computation are equivalent is really strong evidence that there's something in the, you know, in the Platonic world of forms, that this is not a subjective issue. Some functions really are uncomputable, others are not. I think the P versus NP distinction is really fundamental, and so on. You know, I guess in analog computation, I think that there is something, some similar boundary, but so far it's been harder to find, and I agree with you that each of the models I showed was a kind of contingent, you know, it had a particular philosophy or goal behind it. And part of what I was trying to say is it's kind of interesting that there is less consensus about what computation means in the continuous setting. I wouldn't go so far as to say it's subjective then. I would just say we haven't quite nailed it down, or found the most satisfying way to nail it down.
Thanks.
Okay, Michael, and then let's, and anybody can leave at any time. If they don't want to hear Michael's brilliant question and my brilliant answer, but no pressure.
Actually, Simon made me ask this. I didn't want to ask, but but he's gone. you went with analog computers and you tried to go up, right, to make them like really strong so that they would replace digital. But
Shannon went a bit down in some sense, or Shannon and Vinnie Verbusch. I tried to jump up to recursion theory, but yes. Yeah.
So I think what could be really cool is to find, I mean, my intuition says that it's easier to find it in analog cases, an infinite series of analog computers, each of which can compute below it, but can't compute up. So that you know, it gives you kind of an infinite number of layers instead of just saying a P and P, P space. Like that it would give you like...
You mean like a continuum of...
Not a continuum. I thought of a... I mean, it could be that there is a continuum, but I was thinking more of like an infinite series of computational complexity.
Well, that's already true. I mean, strictly speaking, that's already true in the discrete case. So there's something called the time hierarchy theorem. There's also the space hierarchy theorem. So for one thing, we could continue this infinitely. It's common to say, well, exponentials of exponentials and exponentials of those, and then eventually fancier functions like iterated exponentials, all these very fast growing functions. And there are an infinite number of levels between P and computability.
But I want to go down from P.
Down from P. Well, there are hierarchies there too. They're maybe a little bit less exciting to a lot of people, but they exist. So, you know, I mentioned what can you do in logarithmic space, for instance, or logarithmic time with a parallel computer. So you could ramify that in various ways. I mean, there are some interesting theorems. So the time hierarchy theorem actually says something much more powerful, which is that if you fix your computing architecture, what you can do in n to the n squared time is a smaller set than what you can do in n to the 2.00001 time, or even n squared times log n time. And so that's an interesting theorem, but it's a little bit, and people talk about the so-called fine-grained complexity, and there's a lot of interesting work on that right now. Can we show that this is, that unless something is that we strongly believe is false, this can be done in n cubed time, but not n to any smaller constant. One reason these things feel a bit more fragile and maybe a bit more subjective is that they start to depend more and more on your computing architecture. Like even what a Turing machine with two tapes can do in linear, you know, it can do things in linear time that a Turing machine with one tape can't. And we kind of don't want to care that much about that sort of thing, at least on the theory side. I mean, on the practical side, of course, if you have a clever data structure, I mean, this is what the whole field of data structure is about, is doing things in n squared time instead of n cubed time. So there are beautiful ideas there, but they seem maybe a little less fundamental about the structure of the underlying problem. But, you know, that's... Well, that was a subjective statement. All right, I really appreciate it. Thanks very much.